Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Sunday service this morning. May each and every single one of us experience God's grace and closeness as we come together to worship Him and share in the Holy Communion. Ndia nibulisa, nonke ge gama, lenkosi yetu u Jesu Christu. Ek groet julle elk in die naam van ons Here, Jesus Christus. I greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This week, according to our membership list, we have three birthdays coming up. On Friday the 12th, it's Lindsay Thomas and Terry Marshall's birthday. And then on the 13th, which is Saturday, it's Deline Spence's birthday. Happy birthday, ladies, and everybody else celebrating a birthday this week. May you have an absolutely amazing day, and may the Lord bless and keep you in the here to come. Then also just a reminder that I will be going on leave from tomorrow and I'll be away for 2 weeks. So if at any time you need anyone, please do not hesitate to contact any one of the elders. Next week, Zola Gabera will be doing the service, the in-person service for us at the church, and online a pre-recorded service will be going out. Then also just important dates for us to diarize. On the 23rd of November, there will be a session meeting. On the 24th of November, there will be a stewardship committee meeting. And on the 25th of November, we will be having Friends of Compassion in our church building. Let's begin our service by listening and singing along with the hymn, Majesty.
Majesty, worship His majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and
Prophet Nahum calls us to worship this morning with his words from chapter 1, verse 7, where we read the following. The Lord is good, a refuge in times of trouble. He cares for those who trust him. Here the prophet comes to tell us something that we already know. The Lord is good. He is our refuge in times of trouble. And when it seems to us as if our whole worlds are falling apart and crumbling, when we watch the news and read the newspapers and our hearts are gripped with fear, and when we receive those telephone calls that gives us a pit in our stomach, whatever we are going through, God is our refuge. He cares for us. So knowing this, let's draw near to our God. Let's come to worship Him, to enter His holiness, and to spend time with Him, to come and share with the Lord what's going on in our lives, what's on our minds, what's in our hearts, as we come to connect with Him today. And let's start by doing this in silent and individual prayer. Let's pray. Lord God, you are our King. You are the one whom we can rely on, the one we can trust, the one who is always there, ready to comfort us, ready to wipe away our tears, ready to help, ready to provide, ready to teach us, and most importantly, protect us. You are our parent, our keeper, our King, and our friend. Lord, we come to thank you this morning. We come to worship you for all the wonderful things that you do in our lives. Thank you that you are our Lord, our Saviour, and our Almighty King. This morning we humbly approach your throne. We gather here today to worship you. We gather here today to come together as believers and share in the Holy Communion. We come to remember your acts of grace and mercy and love toward us. But as we remember this, we know that we are often found wanting. We make mistakes. We behave wrongly towards you and our fellow brothers and sisters. In our behavior, in our tone, in our attitudes, we sin. We hurt others. We don't always forgive. We deem our wills and needs more important than others. Our egos, pride, and greed often control our thoughts. Our anger, frustration, and irritation often control our tongues. And then we sin. When our thoughts and our tongues and our hearts are not filled with you, we often do what is wrong in your sight. So this morning, Lord, we come to confess our sins to you. And we do this now in silent and individual prayer. Lord, see our hearts, hear our confessions, feel the guilt and shame we have. Come and enfold us in your loving arms. Come and free us with your forgiveness. Come and let your waters of mercy and grace flow over us. Pardon us, cleanse us, accept our confessions if they are acceptable in your sight, and forgive us. Thank you, Lord, that we know when we truly repent, you forgive. When we truly repent, your grace catches us. When we truly repent, you take our sins and you separate it far away from us. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. As we gather here today, we know that there are things that are constantly in the back of our minds. There are feelings we feel that we just can't seem to shake off. We worry about things that keep us up at night. There are things that gnaw at us all the time. We bring these things to you. We place them at your feet. Lord, help us to concentrate on you this morning. Help us to forget about all our to-do lists. Help us to focus on you and spend quality time with you so that we can be rejuvenated, re-energized, and receive your peace and strength from the Holy Spirit this morning. As we open the scriptures, grant us an understanding spirit. Help us to feel your presence, hear your voice, and know that you are here. Grant us understanding as we read the scriptures. Unlock it for us, open it for us, so that we may know you more intimately. We pray this in the name of our Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are now going to listen to the hymn, The Church's One Foundation. Our reading this morning comes from the New Testament, from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 21, verse 5 to 19. And you are more than welcome to follow along with me. I'll be reading from the NIV translation. Luke 21, verse 5 to 19. And here we read the following. Some of his disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus said, "As for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down." "Teacher," they asked, "when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place?" He replied, "Watch out that you are not deceived. For many will come in my name, claiming, 'I am he,' and 'the time is near.' Do not follow them. When you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilence in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. But before all of this, they will seize you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and put you in prison, and you will be brought before kings and governors, all on the account of my name. And so you will bear testimony to me. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourself. For I will give you the words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents, brothers and sisters, relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. Everyone will hate you because of me, but not a hair on your head will perish. Stand firm, and you will win life." Here ends our reading this morning. May the Lord bless to us the understanding of his holy word. Let's take a moment and think back. What are some of the natural disasters and tragedies that you are aware of that happened during your lifetime? Can you think of any? Well, throughout history, there's been natural disasters and tragedies, and they happen all the time. There has been hurricanes like Hurricane Katrina in 2005. There's been wildfires in Australia and California very recently. There's been tragedies like airplanes flying into the World Trade Center in America. And even here in our own country, we've had our own natural disasters and tragedies, like the Lanesburg flood in 1981. Severe drought here in our region for quite a number of years. And most recently, the coronavirus that turned our lives upside down, and it ain't over yet. But what do all these natural disasters and tragedies have in common? Yes, we all know they're horrible. Yes, we've lost people that we love. Children have been orphaned, homes have been destroyed. But what else do all these natural disasters have in common? At some point, certain religious leaders or just religious people in general will say, "These disasters are happening because of God's wrath. God is judging us. God is saying, 'Repent.' God is punishing us. It's because of those people or these people or that sin that God is now acting. The end times are coming." Especially in the last year and a half, we've heard messages and seen videos proclaiming this type of message. People who believe messages like this, people who say things like this, every time there's a natural disaster or tragedy, loves our scripture reading this morning. Because this scripture reading will back their opinion up. It will show them that they are right. it will help them make their point. After all, Luke 21 verse 5 to 19 are all about the end times, all about God's wrath, God's judgment, all about natural disasters, wars and fearful events. Or is it? To understand Luke 21 verse 5 to 19, it's important for us to understand certain nuances in the scripture before we even begin to read this text. It's important for us to understand the context. Remember, in the Reformed tradition, the tradition that we are part of, we must never, ever read only a single verse, because we need to understand where this verse fits into, what the larger context of the book was, who this message was written to, how those people understood it, before we can even begin to interpret what that reading tells us today. And so we need to ask ourselves a couple of questions before we even start with our reading from Luke 21. Exactly where in the Gospel of Luke does Jesus say these words? What was the worldview of the people that Jesus spoke to? What was the worldview of the people that Luke wrote this gospel to? And what type of literary genre is being used here? Well, let's see. As we page through the Gospel of Luke, at this point in the narrative, where are we? In Luke 4, Jesus was baptized. He was tempted by the devil. And then Jesus returned to Galilee. He eventually went to Capernaum, where he then began to teach people in the synagogue. In Luke 5, Jesus was in Gennesaret, where he started to call his disciples. Jesus then started making his way back to Capernaum, back to Galilee. And in Luke 7, we read that he was in Nain, where he then raised a widow's son. For a while, he stayed in that region, often moving back to Capernaum because Capernaum was his base. But in Luke 13, we read that Jesus starts making his way to Jerusalem. And at the border between Galilee and Samaria, Jesus heals the 10 lepers. He and the disciples make their way to Jericho, where Jesus heals the blind man, in Luke 18. And then in Luke 19, we find him entering Jerusalem. In Luke 20, we read that Jesus was in the temple courts preaching the gospel when the teachers of the law and the elders approached him. And they then started asking him all sorts of questions, and soon a very big discussion followed. And it's here where our reading then fits in. Jesus is in Jerusalem, in the temple. He was having a detailed discussion with the most important Jewish issues that were conducted in the most Jewish of settings, the temple, to the most Jewish of people, the teachers of the law. Now, what was the worldview of the people that were hearing Jesus? The temple, as we know, was the center of the Jewish world. It was a place of awe, a place of beauty. In verse 5, we actually read how the disciples were admiring the temple because of how beautiful it was. It was magnificent and it was stunning. It was gigantic. The outer court alone of the temple was big enough to take 400,000 people during a festival. It was a place fit for God. But the temple was also a place of controversy and tension. Why? Because of Herod. Herod called himself the king of the Jews. He spent massive amounts of money on making the temple beautiful and bigger. But Herod also had a reputation. He was brutal, he was vicious, he was barbaric. He even had some of his own family members killed. But he built this temple to rival other temples. The faithful Jews of the time knew that this temple testifies God's unique mystery and majesty. But they also knew that Herod was involved in building and expanding it to glorify himself. He was the grandson of converted Jews, but the rabbis refused to acknowledge Herod as a Jew because of the fact that he was so brutal. Therefore, when Jesus talked about the temple being destroyed in verse 6, it had a double bite. The leveling of the temple will remove the stain of Herod, but at the same time, the temple was the temple. It was the place where God resided. It cannot be destroyed. Such an act was just unthinkable to the people of that time. And so naturally, because of this, the people who heard Jesus' words wanted to know when it will happen. Perhaps they wanted to know because they were curious, but they probably wanted to know so that they could figure out some plans to stop it from happening. Jesus then answers their question in verse 7 by saying, "Watch out that you are not deceived. For many will come in my name, claiming that I am he, and the time is near, but do not follow them." Jesus then starts a list of general catastrophes that will happen. There will be whispers of war and revolutions. They will hear that nations are rising against nations and kingdoms are rising against kingdoms. They will hear of natural disasters. But what the key is that they need to hold on to is to not be fearful. But then Jesus sketches a picture that is even grimmer. Jesus speaks of the persecution of those who follow him. They will be delivered to synagogues and prisons. They will be brought before kings and governors. And when this happens, they mustn't see it as something bad, but rather as an opportunity. Because this will be the time where they will have the opportunity to bear witness to God. Jesus even takes it further still when he says in verse 14 and 15, "Make up your mind not to worry beforehand." Or, "Don't worry about how you're going to defend yourselves. For I will give you words of wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict." The Greek word that we find here that is translated with the many words that says, "Make up your mind not to worry beforehand," is a word that means that we need to plan ahead of time with considerable thought and attention. What? Wait a minute. Is Jesus serious? If we know that we are going to be persecuted and jailed and tortured and hurt and all those things, isn't it normal that we must sit down and think with considerable thought and attention to plans that we can develop to try and protect ourselves? Isn't that the rational thing to do? How can we not make plans? How can we not worry and be fearful? Well, the reason we shouldn't make plans, worry, and be fearful is given to us in verse 18. Not a hair on your head will perish. This proverb about hair and head is something that we find throughout the Old Testament. It's a proverb that shows divine protection. We find it in 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, Kings, and also here in Luke and Matthew. And then our reading ends off with the words, "By standing firm, you will gain life." Now, there are also two important things that we need to bear in mind here. Firstly, what is the context of the time that Luke then actually writes this gospel in? Luke's gospel was written in the year 85. This means 15 years after the temple was destroyed by the Romans in the year 70. Therefore, one could say that this section in the gospel of Luke is a reflection on what already happened. It is a statement of how temporary human achievement actually is. But secondly, this statement that we read is also part of apocalyptic literature. And the most famous part in the Bible that is written in apocalyptic literature is, of course, the book of Revelations. And when we look at the book of Revelations, what do we think it's all about? The end times, right? That's what we think. But is that true? If it isn't, how are we supposed to interpret this type of literature? Do we read it and see it as literal predictions? Or do we read it in the light of the aims that the apocalyptic literature intends? Apocalyptic literature is a very, very specific genre, like poems or stories or letters. Now, if you are going to get a letter from the love of your life, the way you read that letter is going to be very different to the way you read your bill that you get from the municipality, right? The genre of a document and who it comes from always helps us and aids us to interpret that reading. So how should we read apocalyptic literature? Well, apocalyptic literature makes use of unsettling language and imagery as a means to assure the faithful that they should keep their trust in God, even if their circumstances are challenging. Bringing us back to the section of Luke, every age there are false prophets. There are natural disasters. There are wars. Bad things happen. And bad things will continue to happen. But we shouldn't be terrified, as verse 9 says. We shouldn't follow anyone proclaiming the end is near. Jesus is there or Jesus is here. Because that's what Jesus warns us against in verse 8. Instead, we should place our trust in God. He will give us the wisdom and the words that we need. That is a promise that he makes to us in verse 15, because we belong to him, and therefore we are under his divine protection, because we are his children, every single one of us, no matter what our sins are. Not a hair on our head will be harmed. Having said that, this is not a superficial way out. It also doesn't mean that God doesn't take our pain and suffering seriously, because he does. No matter who we are, we will experience bad things. We will suffer. Our pain will be real. At times, we will feel like our heart has been ripped out of our chest. But in these times, God is with us. There are times in our lives where we will have the opportunity to bear witness to God, and they won't always be comfortable times. But we need to point people towards God. If we continue reading the Gospel of Luke, we find chapter 21, that the destruction of the temple actually leads to a geopolitical chaos, which leads to a religious and social rejection, but it ends in the promise of safety. This reading comes to remind us, especially as we come to sit around the communion table today, that whatever chaotic, earth-shattering, heart-wrenching catastrophe we may be facing, or we will face in the future, God is with us. Not a hair on our head will be harmed. He will never let us go. He will always be at our side. He will go with us through the wars, through the natural disasters, through the illnesses and diseases we get, all the suffering and all the pain. Through it all, God will be with us. David Livingstone, a missionary that came to Africa, once prayed, "Lord, send me anywhere, only go with me. Lay any burden on me, only sustain me." In this scripture reading, that is exactly what Jesus comes to tell us. Wherever you may go, God is with you. Whatever burden you may face, God will sustain you. However, we should also remember that we are in it together as a community of sinners, washed in Christ's blood. We are here to serve one another, uphold one another, pray for one another, and encourage one another, not break each other down. As we come to the communion table today, may God come to feed us spiritually, come to remind us of his closeness and his love for us. Come and remind us of his forgiveness. Grant us his grace, and come to carry those burdens that we are so heavily laying on our shoulders. He protects us, and he is always at our side. He is with us yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you that you are with us. Thank you that you carry us, that you are always close, that you care for us. Protect us and love us. You know, Lord, the things that we face, the things that we go through, the challenges that cause our hearts to beat faster and anxiety to grow in the pit of our stomachs. You know the problems we have, the burdens we carry, the loads on our shoulders, the worries we have. You also know the things that we are fearful of and fearful for. Lord, come and wrap us in your arms. Send us anywhere, but go with us. Lay any burden on us, but sustain us. Carry us through every moment of every day so that we may feel and experience your closeness, your strength, and your protection. We pray, Lord, especially this morning for the Ruiz family with the passing of Anne. Wrap her children and grandchildren in your arms. Wipe away their tears, comfort them, and give them the strength that they need. We pray for all in our midst who are grieving, all who are in pain, all who are suffering. Lord, come and carry us. Come and lead us. Come and guide us. As we prepare ourselves to meet you at the holy table, Lord, come and meet us. Come and prepare us. Come and open our hearts to your presence. We ask this in your holy name. Amen. We are now going to listen to the communion hymn, Be Still. Please make sure that you have all your elements ready, your juice, wine, and your bread, so that we can celebrate the communion together. Let's listen to Be Still.
Be still.
Gather here this morning around God's table, and anybody who's joining us or tuning in is more than welcome to join us in the communion, for this is God's table. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He who comes to me, I will never, ever send away." Beloved in the Lord, attend to the words of the institution of the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ, as it's given to us by St. Paul, who wrote, "I've received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup. He drank from it and said, 'This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for the remission of sins. Drink of it
in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show forth the Lord's death till he comes again. Therefore, that we may fulfill his institution in righteousness and in joy, let us follow his blessed example in word and action, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread and wine, I now take these elements to be set apart for his holy use. Let's pray. O God, our Heavenly Father, we, your unworthy children, praise and bless your holy name for the majesty of your glory and for the wonder of your works. With all your faithful people everywhere, in heaven and on earth, we praise and adore you, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth is full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Not as we ought, but as we are able, we thank you for his life, his perfect obedience even to death upon a cross, his glorious resurrection from the dead, his ascension into heaven, where he is seated at your right hand, making intercession for us. We thank you for the promised gift of the Holy Spirit and pray that the Spirit may sanctify both us and these your gifts of bread and wine, which we now set apart to your sacred and holy use. That the bread which we break may be to us the communion of the body of Christ, and the cup of blessings which we bless, the communion of the blood of Christ, so that we through faith may be partakers of his body and his blood, with all its benefits to our spiritual nourishment and growth in grace. O God, as we now make memorial of him in the sacrament of his appointing, in fellowship with your church, in heaven and on earth, we offer to you ourselves, a living sacrifice, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. According to the holy institution, example, and command of our Jesus Christ, and in remembrance of him, we do this. The same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. After he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup. After he had blessed it, he said, This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for the remission of sins. Drink of it in remembrance of me. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, Redeemer of the world, have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, as you take away the sins of the world, grant us your peace. Take, eat, the body of Christ is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of him. This cup is the new covenant of the blood of Christ shed for the remission of sins. Drink of it in remembrance of him. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Let us pray. O Lord God, we bless you for your great goodness to us at your holy table. Give us grace that we may not be disobedient to your heavenly vision, but that we may serve you more faithfully day by day. We remember before you your whole church, asking that you will give your people everywhere more abundant faith and hope and love. Deepen our love for you. Increase our knowledge of your truth, so that we can be quickened and guided by your Spirit, so that we can be cleansed from sin and saved to righteousness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Eternal God, we thank you for all whom you have taken to yourself, all prophets, martyrs, saints, and holy ones of every age. Especially we remember those whom we love, who serve you now in your nearer presence. Keep us worthy of all those who have gone before us and who now live with you. And let the same mind be in us, which is also in Christ Jesus, that we may daily deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow you. Grant us, O Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honour and glory, world without end. Amen.
We are now going to listen to the hymn, Brother, Sister, Let Me Serve You.
Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. We are pilgrims on a journey, we're companions on the road. We are here to help each other walk the mile and bear the load.
I will hold the Christ light for you in the night time of your fear. I will hold my hand out to you, speak a peace to
I'll laugh with you. I will share your joy and sorrow till we've seen this journey through.
When we sing to God in heaven, we shall find such harmony. For of all we've known together, of Christ's love and agony. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may
Ubabalo le nkosi yetu u Yesu Kristu, utando luka tiko, ubutlelwana lo moyo u yinkwele, malube nani nonke. En nou mag die genade van Christus, die liefde van God en die gemeenskap van die Heilige Gees met elkeen van ons wees en bly. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and all those whom you love, now and forevermore. Amen.
Let there be